Hello, Dr. Deglio. How are you doing today?
Oh, wonderful, Dr. Rick. How are you?
Very good. Thank you. Very good. Just got back from a trip to Florida this past week. We had a bit of an early spring break that we were able to go on. And so we had a nice little family trip down to Legoland in Orlando and Sea World. So we did kind of a day drive, a day at Legoland, a day at Sea World, and then a day drive back. So it was kind of a quick, busy trip, but we just got back from doing that. So
I'm very jealous of Legoland, Rick. What was, forget about the kids. What did you like about Legoland?
You know, it's interesting you say that, Nick, because I kind of had the impression going in, or the expectation going in, that we were doing this for Toby, because he's been begging to go to Legoland for like 6 years, seriously, like 6 years. And so we thought, well, we'll go for him and he'll like it. And, you know, that'll be his dream thing that he gets to go do. But we all loved it. We all loved it. What a cool place that was. We seriously, a lot, so many family rides to do, so much. I mean, it was beautiful. The landscaping was gorgeous. The Lego sculptures were just phenomenal. I mean, it was mind blowing what these Lego artists do. So we loved it. We had a great day. The park was at about a 40% capacity, which made it so like we waited for one ride the entire day.
Oh, wow.
More than 10 minutes. I mean, everything was less than 10 minutes. Most rides, we just walked right on. And we waited for one ride at the very end of the day. But man, it was just a great day. In fact, Toby said, "This is one of the best days of my life." That was his reaction. Like, oh, now that, man, yeah, that's worth a lot right there.
But yep, that's a big win.
We all enjoyed it. We all enjoyed it. So highly fantastic. Recommend Legoland, surprisingly.
All right. It's good to hear. How about SeaWorld? It's been years since I've even thought about SeaWorld.
You know, I had never been to SeaWorld, so this was new for me. Both parks were new for me, and I was just excited to see the killer whale show. I kind of had the expectation that, you know, that's why I wanted to go. In fact, I didn't know there was really a whole lot else to it, but there is. It's, you know, this probably because you've been there. There's rides. There's tons of roller coasters, which Kaylee and Desi were just spent all day really riding the coasters, and Christy and I took Holly and Toby to do the other stuff. But great dolphin shows, amazing killer whale shows, to be sure. Like the best river rapids ride we've ever been on. It was wicked and intense.
Oh, wow.
The killer whale show, the park was probably at like a 60, 70% capacity. So it was a little more crowded than Legoland, but it was still like, we didn't wait very long to get on stuff. And we sat right down in the splash zone for all the shows. And speaking of the splash zone, I mean, the killer whale show, we got drenched. You know, they came and like, you know, the trainers made them splash everybody in the splash zones with their huge, tails. And oh my goodness, it was another great day. Really, it was just a ton of fun and great family, memorable times that we got to spend. So, yeah, all pluses for me for SeaWorld as well.
And it looked like one of the concession stands also had Cheetos popcorn.
That's right. They did. We didn't get the line was so long and we were kind of running late to the whale show. So we didn't stop to get in that line. And then, of course, they closed the concessions right after the show. So we didn't get to get it then. But we saw it there. It's there. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's good to know. It's good to know it's still out in the world making its presence felt and heard.
How have things been going with you, Nick?
It's been a crazy week or so. However, I was just hoping to give an update on the Just Bare lightly breaded chicken chunks. Danielle and I, as you remember, we were at about an 80 to 85% likeness to the Chick-fil-A nuggets.
Right.
And that was with oven preparation. So we tried again with air fryer preparation. And we just went plain air fryer the first time, didn't add any oil, just because I didn't want to mix up the variables like we had discussed. Yeah. And I would say just using the air fryer alone put us between 91 to 94% Chick-fil-A nugget accuracy.
Wow.
Our final test is going to be adding a little bit of peanut oil and then seeing how much higher that percentage can go. So I would say we are pretty much at, we're in A territory in terms of taste at this point, which is incredibly impressive. What I'm going to do before I give the final update, Rick, will be I will certainly do the full cost breakdown, meaning I'll take the bag, you know, figure out how many servings would be in like a 10 or a 12. I believe it's 6 and 12 Chick-fil-A sells them. And then we'll do a cost comparison as well to see what the, what the difference is there. But yeah, just thought I'd give the update on where we are there.
That is really impressive. Nick, do they just come in like the chunks, like the nuggets, or do they come in like the filets or patties for sandwiches?
You know, that's a great question. That's a really good question. I don't know the answer to that. Danielle actually does the shopping at Costco. I refuse to go into that store unless it's a off weeknight. I will never go on a weekend. It's just, it stokes my anxiety way too much, but I'll do some digging on that too. So it'll be a thorough update I can give you.
You know, if they don't, I have a recommendation. If they don't come in the patties and you're, you know, hangry for a like a chicken sandwich, right? And the nuggets won't cut it. If you go to Aldi, they have what's called red bag chicken. Go to the freezer section. It's called red bag chicken. There are Facebook groups for red bag chicken. It is very popular because it's got a Chick-fil-A taste to it for sure.
So
Desi and I are kind of big red bag chicken fans here at the house. So that's something to check out.
We will absolutely give that a shot. We have several Aldis in the area. So that's an easy stop in and check for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool.
Exciting. All right. Well, I believe it's time for a blog. And this time, Rick, I believe it is an interesting counselor type activity you're talking about.
It is. I got some feedback from the one I did a few weeks ago from some of my students and former students who appreciated me kind of talking through two truths and a lie. And they wanted more kind of descriptions of some activities that I've used. So I thought, well, yeah, let me go ahead and describe one of my favorites. So this one's called the Newspaper Tower Challenge. One of my favorite group counseling activities is called the Newspaper Tower Challenge. I'm not sure exactly who came up with it, but the idea is to separate whatever group or class you have into several equal subgroups, about 4 to 8 people per group. Give each subgroup a stack of newspaper, a roll of duct tape, and instruct them to make the tallest self-supporting tower not attached to floors, walls, desks, chairs, ceilings, etc., that they can make in a given amount of time, usually about 10 minutes, using only those materials. For years, I facilitated this activity as an effective kinesthetic precursor to meaningful debriefing, reflecting on strategies, decision-making, communication skills, and leadership. As a professional counselor, the key is to spend more time on the discussion than on the activity itself, and to draw out the metaphors by comparing and contrasting what happened in the activity to what happens in real life. Insights, meaningful experiences, strengths, and areas for growth. I consistently find that participants really enjoy completing the challenge, and it is a really effective prompt for meaningful conversation on key issues relevant for groups, such as general education sixth graders, alternative school teenagers, young adults, court-ordered counseling for drinking under the influence, teachers in training, practicing professional school counselors, and so many more that I've used this activity with. Invariably, however, every group that I ever work with would turn this activity into a competition, with each subgroup striving to build their tower taller than the other groups. Each group, and not just the kids, would get so into the competition to beat the other teams, it didn't matter how many times I said, this isn't a competition. In fact, I think that even mentioning the word competition would often make it worse. A few years ago, I tired of pushing back against the competition and decided to use it to my advantage. I was teaching a graduate counseling class on diversity, awareness, and appreciation. With a bit of advanced preparation, I was ready to make a few adjustments to the activity. When I walked around to distribute the materials, I gave one group considerably less newspaper, just a few pages, and a mostly used roll of duct tape. What transpired was incredible. I have since done this activity with many different groups of a wide range of ages, abilities, and backgrounds, and almost exactly the same thing happens every time. The group or groups loaded down with plenty of supplies, a huge stack of newspaper, and several full rolls of duct tape go to work building the tallest tower they can, keeping an eye on the other subgroup's progress, not noticing or ignoring the fact that they have considerably more resources than one of the other teams. The under-resourced subgroup typically notices that they were issued less pretty quickly, and on occasion will point that out, even complain from time to time. More often than not, however, they just go to work with what they have. It seems to me that when all is said and done, this group ends up being more proud of their tower than the other groups, regardless of how the final height compares. But the most astounding thing to me is to hear the reactions from the over-resourced groups when they find out they had more to begin with. They almost invariably feel guilty, perhaps embarrassed, that they were so laser-focused on building their tower higher than the other teams that they didn't even consider whether or not the playing field was equal. The privileged groups almost always contend that they would have shared their resources if they would have known. The idea of this activity, however, is not to make anyone feel guilty or embarrassed or diminish their accomplishment. The goal, rather, is to prompt a good conversation about the importance of mindful awareness of disparities as a prerequisite for compassion, altruism, and advocating for equal opportunities. I've added a few other touches over the years as well, depending upon the group focus and goals. In one scenario, I bring extra supplies and put them in a pile in front of the room. When the under-resourced subgroup inevitably walks to the front of the room to request more newspaper and duct tape, I respond by telling them that I'll give them some if they put on plain white t-shirts prepared in advance and blazoned with words like ADHD and learning disability spelled out in bold black lettering across the chest. What an amazing prompt for a conversation about the challenges, positives, and negatives regarding diagnoses and stigma. So what does this have to do with you? You're a helping professional, right? A counselor, a teacher, an administrator, a coach, a parent. You wouldn't allow competitiveness to blind you to disparities, would you? I would. I have. And as the Grinch says at the end of the movie, holding his hands out to be handcuffed, and I'm sorry, I can do better. I can pay closer attention to the resources that my clients and students have or don't have. I can look to share more of what I have in ways that help others be more resilient without drawing attention to myself and without fostering dependence. How about you? What students, clients, athletes, or teachers do you work with that could use a little extra support? And how could you subtly reach out to offer that support? May you have eyes to see and a heart to help. There are likely many of you reading this or listening to this essay that do just that day after day. Your internal radar is set to identify those who are hurting, struggling, or trying to get by with less than others. To you, thank you for sharing your life with others. Thank you for your selfless sacrifice and service. You're making a significant difference, even when you can't see it. Your tower is growing as you help others build theirs. Lastly, I want to encourage you to feel good about what you're doing and the important work. As Friedrich Nietzsche is quoted to have said, love your neighbors as yourself, but first be such as love themselves. Another long one, Nick.
Well, I think sometimes you have to have a longer blog post to get all the good information that's in there out. And that's exactly what this one does. In addition to giving a good description, I think, of what the activity can do and ways you can supplement it to make it even more meaningful or, going in a different direction, depending on like what you're actually like shooting for. It really moves people to think about what happens in the heat of the moment, and then what happens when you reflect upon things afterwards. And then I think starting there might be a great part of the conversation, because that's where, for me, that's where this hits home. Given the past couple of weeks and just a lot of things we've been seeing, whether it's been at work, at home, in the news, it's that oftentimes we go through our days working hard at our jobs, working hard at being parents, working hard at being friends. And a lot of times we make a variety and a large number of decisions that we kind of make in the moment, right? That you don't necessarily give a whole lot of thought to. And then sometimes in the aftermath of those things, you look back and you say, oh, I missed that, or I didn't see that, or I wish I had seen that or done that. And then it becomes a question of, how do we handle that? And you reference, I think, in the article where the Grinch says, I'm sorry, I can do better. And sometimes it's as simple as that. We just strive to do what's right or to make things better in situations where we're able to do that. In the helping profession, I think it's always been a case of self-reflection. And I think what your article rightly points out is that we have to spend more time saying thank you to the people who are working in those professions and being willing to do those things. And at the same time, encourage them to go easy on themselves, because I think it's really easy given the culture, politically that we live in today, where whether you're on the left, whether you're in the right, whether you're in the middle, there's always going to be someone there to criticize anything you're doing. And in the end, the question becomes, well, did you do what you thought was right? And also remembering that for all the hate and all the stuff that might be out there from other people, there's probably just as many people appreciating and supporting the things and the efforts you're making or trying to do. So, you know, that last paragraph in particular really, really kind of hit home for sure. You know, encouraging people to realize what they do, that's making a difference day in and day out there.
Yeah. Yeah. Awareness is such a prerequisite to all this, right? Awareness of what you're doing and what others are doing, what resources others have, what resources you have. I mean, awareness is kind of a first step towards all of this. And I agree with you. I don't know that we express appreciation enough in and around education. Too often it feels to me like everybody's trying to build their tower and compete. So we pit like parents against teachers or teachers against administrators or administrators against parents that somehow we forget that we're all in it for the students or we ought to be all in it for the same people wanting the best for those people. Now we might have some different ideas about how to do that, but we all want the same thing. We all want kids to have success. And it's unfortunate that you know, we don't express our appreciation to each other more to kind of help bridge gaps and work together to solve some of those problems.
And what's interesting too is, you know, you look at the groups who are building the towers and however many times, dozens, maybe hundreds that you've done the activity, and you look at that final product and you look at another group's final product and you could say, what would it have looked like had maybe those groups shared the resources? Part of the competition might have been more driven to compete for a common cause? You know what I mean? Like, what's the total height of all those groups as opposed to the total height of just your group? And does that serve more of your constituents and whatever that constituency may be? Gives a lot to think about there, especially also in the lens of, we talk about the stigma, with the t-shirts. It's like, okay, well, we can give you more, but now you just have to, you know, you're going to look different. That's going to, will that affect your decision and whether or not you'll accept those resources? And we, you know, for those who work in schools, you see that every day, special education students going into classrooms that they know are, everyone knows is a learning support classroom. They don't want to look different, or going into the testing center, or, you know, leaving another class for extra help, or the cafeteria for extra help. And, like we've said it before, especially middle school, it's a 180 day journey trying to not look different, trying to avoid embarrassment. Which gives us as adults a lot to think about, you know, when we make those decisions to call kids out of class or whatever we're doing there.
Oh, well said.
Really, really gives a lot to consider.
Yeah. I love that idea. I'm almost imagining a different prompt that I don't think I've ever done is, you know, the goal is to reach a certain height of all, you know, using this activity of all three groups or four groups combined, right? That's how we'll determine success or failure, not necessarily your individual groups. That would give a new spin to it, especially if one group was loaded down with duct tape, another loaded down with newspaper, and another not with anything, right? It just would. It would be interesting to do it that way and to see what kind of conversation gets elicited. So, yeah.
Regardless, there's another tool in the toolbox for all the listeners out there to use, any variation of this activity, whether it's with adults, with students, with clients. I mean, just so many applications, I think, across the board that can be played with this is awesome.
It's a good point, Nick, because I've never done this with a group. And again, I've done it across wide range of ages and abilities, really. And I've never had a group who thought this was dumb. Like, now we get to play with newspaper and tape and build stuff. Like, every group I've ever worked with just immediately loves it. So there are probably exceptions out there, but I haven't seen it yet. So it's fun. It's fun. A great way to kind of engage folks, starting where at a good place of doing something fun together. There's all kinds of value just in that, but then kind of having a good conversation about using as a metaphor. I just think that's just a good approach, I think, for counseling or teaching.
Absolutely. Yeah, I can't emphasize enough just things that will lead to that type of discussion and reflection. There's always going to be an outcome that'll be valuable for someone along the way doing that.
Yeah. Hey, Nick, let's go ahead and transition. We're continuing on with the Search Institute's developmental assets. And so we got through the first 20. So this is kind of a marking point for us. We've gone through the first 20, which were primarily external assets when we're looking at kind of the support that kids derive, and teenagers especially, derive from community and teachers and family and right, kind of all those external supports. And now we're moving things a little bit to talk about internal supports, or frame them more so towards internal supports that kids have, strengths and abilities and talents, that they've got. And so we're moving on to number 21 and number 22. So real briefly here, asset number 21 is achievement motivation. And this one is briefly described as the young person is motivated to do well in school, or the task under consideration. Number 22, school engagement. The young person is actively engaged in learning and in their learning environment.
And also, Rick, important to point out that assets 21 through 25, so the next couple episodes, they're kind of categorized under the heading of commitment to learning. So it's a very, these assets are grouped together, I guess you could say.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways. When we start talking about 21, young person is motivated to do well in school. That's a loaded asset right there, because so many of the previous assets we've discussed go into that motivation.
Yeah. Sure.
And by the time that student walks into school, the first day of compulsory school and the first day of kindergarten, there's a lot of the table is already set in this regard. Mm-hmm. However, what's great, because they're young, malleable minds, is that the value of education can be learned really at any stage throughout the developmental process. We look at the differences in families and cultures and across the in complete demographic. And there's definitely the school of thought, which was in the, I would say, mid to late 90s, that, the only way to get ahead is that every student has to go to college. You need that college degree. That's the only way to demonstrate success in life. And we've talked about a number of times here, that motivation now looks a little different in that the different tech fields that are out there, and that we need plumbers and carpenters and master craftsmen and welders and all types of the professions, where it's not taking on a huge amount of that student debt for skills that are needed are going to really pay off. So is the motivation, what is that motivation leading to? When we say motivated to do well in school, that doesn't necessarily mean a one-stop shop and everyone's going to college anymore. And I think that's important for people to hear, because, for example, there could be a family who has an independent business, right? Their family business. And the expectation is that all kids are going to go into that business. Or a family who, owns a dairy farm and everyone works on that farm, and that's the expectation. Well, guess what? There's a lot of avenues that school can help make that work even better and provide more benefit to what that business might look like. Or maybe that student or that child has a whole different direction that they're going to realize their life should go because they want to do something different, or they have a different gift they want to offer the world, and it may play out that way. But it all goes back to what is the value of education, and how do we find education in, how do we define it in 2023?
Yeah. And hopefully it's relevant to any or all of those different kind of paths that kids can choose kind of post-secondary. I think from a counseling perspective, this is difficult because I find it very difficult. I know a lot of my students find it very difficult to work with apathetic students or clients. It's just challenging. And oftentimes, we get the sense or feeling that we're working harder than they are. That's a terrible place to be as a counselor, where you're working harder than your student or your client is working, right? That's a red flag right there. Whoa, something's got to change. Something's got to be different, because we can't do it, right? We get half an hour out of a week, if that. And so the kiddo, the client, the person, they've got to be motivated to make changes, because they're the one who lives life and does things different. So what do you do about that? Well, I think there's a couple. First is tracing back to what we just talked about, self-awareness or an awareness of the situation. Kid's not motivated. I'm more motivated than they are, right? Or my client's not motivated. I'm more motivated. What do we do different? Well, I think one is you can kind of engage with the client or the student to have them get more invested, set a goal. That's not your goal for them. It's their goal for them. It's what they want. And you come alongside them to help them to reach their goal so that they can have success. And it's not only, kind of engaging them in the goal setting process, but it's engaging them in the process to reach that goal. So how are we going to do it? What do you want to do differently or the same to achieve that goal, right? It's your goal. It's your process. And I think we're very careful with the way we frame things, even when we're talking with kids, so that they feel invested in the goals they set and in the processes they're going to go about to reach that goal. It's just, I think most kids, most people have this natural kind of inclination for achievement, but under the right conditions and support. And so another thing that we can do is we can change the nature of the conditions, right? Or the nature of the support. So sometimes that means medications, counseling, skill development. We change the type of instruction we provide. We change the level of challenge to cultivate more success that can kind of help motivate kids. One other piece I would add, Nick, another kind of take on this. I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Antoine Fisher. Great movie. Yep. 2002. Denzel Washington directed it and stars in it. And he's a Navy psychiatrist in it. And there's this great kind of sequence where this kid, Antoine, right, young man, Antoine, comes to counseling or comes to see Denzel and doesn't want to do anything. He's completely apathetic. He doesn't want to engage. He doesn't want to talk. And so Denzel just sits with him. He's just patient. He lays out the boundaries, but he's like, all right, well, I'll be here when you're ready to talk. Right. I think sometimes to me, it's a great scene to kind of show to my students to remind them that, look, we can't force people in a direction. We can create a good environment where people feel safe and we can be patient. And that's hard to do. We've talked about that in the past, right? In the great blog you wrote on all you need is just a little patience and the importance of spacing. And we've talked about this, but we can't kind of emphasize it enough that we have to be patient when we're working with kids. Not patient in the sense of, not losing our temper. Yeah, that's important. But we're talking about, just being patient, trusting what we're doing. And providing good conditions for kids to grow, because they will, given the right conditions and given the right time. I always tell my school counseling students, sometimes kids just aren't ready. And that's not to diminish or take away, but it's just true. They're not ready. So you provide the conditions, you provide opportunity. And while they may not be ready for it right now, they might be next year if they had a positive experience with you in the waiting. So anyway, those are some thoughts I had to this one.
Yeah, for sure. I would just add the one more piece there. And you talk about that growth and patience and the waiting and sometimes that need to wait. And when we, achievement motivation, young person is motivated. And I would say, 10 times out of 10, discipline trumps motivation every time, right? So good habits will trump. Yeah. Because eventually motivation, you're tired, you get beat down a little bit, you stop seeing the purpose behind it, right? So it's the commitment to the routine, it's the commitment to the grind that you're going to hit an end goal. But if the students at some point don't see or understand what that end goal could be for them, then there is no motivation, right? There is no point to have discipline if they don't understand what the value of what we're trying to give them is. And oftentimes, you need to learn this. And well, why? Yeah. We're not really always good at the why, because I said so. And we can't expect, think about you in elementary school or you in middle school or you in high school even. At what point did you really understand, if ever, what the value of that educational experience across those 13 years actually was? So we have to continually reinvent ourselves and convey the message so the students understand what we're expecting them to be motivated for.
Yeah. Great point. Yeah. And to the extent that we can kind of help them connect the dots and see how the work is relevant, I think that kind of leads towards motivation for sure. You mentioned habits, Nick, and I'm reminded of a great book. Maybe we've talked about it in the podcast already. It's Atomic Habits by James Clear. What a great book. I've gone through this once and I'm on my second way through it. And there's just so much good stuff in there. I'm thinking it's at least something that we ought to talk about kind of as an episode or a series of episodes, because it's so good. Highly recommend this for teachers and administrators and school counselors and coaches. It's just so good. There's so much good stuff in it, kind of not on two different levels, right? On us as professionals, on what, how we can manage and change our habits, but also helping the people and the kids that we work with kind of develop good habits. So, yeah.
Now, the asset 22, when we start talking about the word engagement and saying the young person's actively engaged in learning. So our prior superintendent, her name was Dr. M. Lenardi. She helped us identify for the district three pieces that you know, she felt would really contribute to overall student learning and achievement. And it was essentially those three were rigor, engagement, and agency. And we spent the better part of a year defining each one of those three things across the administrative team, across the teaching team, school board, you know, throughout the district. And, you know, after 12 months of work on the engagement piece, here's what we came up with, which is a one sentence summary of what we believed student engagement was. And it goes, students are actively invested in relevant and intentional instructional experiences that inspire them to apply and extend their learning. Now, that's one sentence that took a year to codify and come together. And the important terms that we really felt were inherent throughout this definition is one, students are actively, right? That means they are participating, they are a part of, they're not just receiving. Invested, that means they've bought in, right? The instructional experiences, it's not necessarily an activity or a lesson. It could be an experience, which could be a million things, right? That are relevant and intentional. Intentional. I mean, you really got to think about that word, right? What does it mean to be intentional? And that, what do those experiences do? Those experiences inspire, right? Yeah. From the Greek inspiros, which is to light, you know, catch flame to a passion, you know, and desire. And then what do? They apply the learning and they extend their learning. And that all comes after that piece there. So student engagement is really a complicated thing when you really, you know, break it down. So to have that as one of the assets and to really have put a lot of thinking behind what the definition means, it's not a throwaway. You know, there's a lot to think about there. And for those, you know, in any field who are working with students who are in a middle class environment or higher, right? There's a difference between student engagement and student compliance. Because most students, and once you reach a certain socioeconomic level, you know, just going to school, they're going to quote unquote behave. They're going to follow expectations. They're going to comply. But complying and engagement are very different things. And you're not really necessarily learning when you're just complying. So I think that's also an important difference, is that it's one thing if your kid just goes through the school day doing what they're supposed to do because that's what they're supposed to do. But really buying in, engaging, and participating is a whole different piece as well. So that's a little piece I wanted to throw in on that asset.
Oh, so much good stuff, Nick. And I love that statement. It's almost like a statement of purpose, it sounds like. That's how it was developed, or a guiding statement. Yeah. I love that. Yeah, so well said. Something came to mind as you were sharing that. Experience, learning experience versus a lecture.
Yeah.
Providing information, providing, reading assignments versus a learning experience. Very different, right? And I'm thinking in my head, but can a lecture be an experience? Yeah, but it takes work. takes work to do that and to make it engaging and to make it interactive. It can be, but it can also just be boring drivel, right? That students are supposed to absorb because they're highly motivated. Oh well, you're going to get a few, but you're going to get lots who won't, right? Uh-huh. And if they do, it'll only be for extrinsic reasons, like to pass the class, as opposed to intrinsic reasons because they're developing a passion for the information. So much good stuff here. And so much of what you were just kind of talking about connects back to kind of what we were just talking about with achievement motivation, right? You're talking about that active engagement and investment, making things relevant. When you do those things, right? When you do those things, kids are engaged and they're motivated. These kind of things can go together. From a school counseling standpoint, the words or the phrase that comes to mind for me is one that I present on a lot, which is school connectedness, which is a bit different, but it's also related here to the idea of school engagement. Because it's not just academic engagement, it's not just engagement with the material, but it's engagement, right, and connectedness to the school environment.
Right.
And so this is something that ought to be on school counselors' radars, and truthfully, administrators as well. I believe strongly that school counselors ought to be regularly assessing students' school connectedness. And when we say school connectedness, what we're talking about is kids' thoughts and feelings regarding connection to teachers, coaches, friends, counselors, and their school in general. How connected do they think and feel to their school? And President Obama made an amazing statement a number of years ago that this is the single most important construct in the field of education. School connectedness. It matters. We've got so much research that tells us when kids feel connected to their schools, they succeed academically. When kids don't feel connected to their schools, they don't succeed academically. I mean, it's very clear. And you might think, well, gosh, but this is going to be terribly difficult to kind of assess that, isn't it? Five questions. Five questions.
Ooh, five questions.
Five question from the Ad Health Likert style questions from the Ad Health survey. It is so easy peasy to measure.
Get your paper and pencils ready, everybody listening. Get your paper and pencils ready.
I don't have my five questions up, Nick. I don't have them up.
don't get your pencils ready, everybody. In fact, we're going to come back to that. Wait with bated breath because we're going to give you that.
That is all it takes, though. It's the school connected subscale from the Ad Health survey. They're very straightforward, and it's a great way to measure not only individual connectedness, but also kind of a corporate connectedness of the way your student body is feeling. So what do you do about it? Well, I think you help kids get and feel connected to each other, right? You set up experiences where they can bond and get to know each other. You kind of get them into whatever extracurriculars fit their dispositions and their abilities and their interests. Mentoring programs, I find, are terribly underused. There's so much benefit to mentoring programs. And I know they're, very difficult to kind of coordinate for sure, but there's so much value on it. Research is so strong on mentoring programs. School climate initiatives and school climate anti-bullying programs, those things are getting at the same thing. They're helping kids to feel comfortable in the school setting and therefore more connected. So this is an important one, I think, for folks in school administration and teachers and school counselors in particular.
Yeah. And you look at the history of that, when you're looking at a federal government statement, right? Or the president of the United States talking about the importance of that. And then we look today where we're sitting in 2023, and a lot of people are saying, man, it's things have changed recently. It's like, well, okay, let's take a look at the period of time where schools were closed. Man, even harder to get that connectedness feel when we weren't in school for that long period of time. And then how do we reestablish that now? Well, guess what? That's going to take work. That's not something we can't expect. And we've seen this right last year and into this year. We've returned to school, but it's work to get things back to where they were, where they should be, what they have to be for that connectedness piece. So a lot of work still to do based on a lot of the damage that was done, during the pandemic, for sure.
Yeah. Nick, I've got those questions I can share with our listeners here. I had it a minute ago. I'll get it. So here they are. This is from the Ad Health School Counseling Subscale. Here they are. I feel close to people at this school, ranging from never, rarely, sometimes, frequently, or always. Number two, I'm happy to be at this school. Number three, I feel like I'm part of this school. Number four, the teachers at this school treat students fairly. And number five, I feel safe in my school. That's it. Five questions. And that's typically, for research purposes, that's what we use in this field. We use those five questions to determine if kids feel connected, again, individually or corporately. And I think a great screener to identify kids who don't maybe feel safe to provide interventions to help them feel and get connected.
Absolutely. And just a very important temperature check, if nothing else, several times a year get the answers to those questions. And, you know, as a school leader, you know, I can tell you, sometimes it's hard hearing the answers to that question when you see the results of that populate. And then you just kind of have to like brush yourself off and get up and say, okay, now what do we do about that? Which is definitely something, you know, important.
Yeah. Like a great point about assessment. When you go to collect data, you know, it's a little scary because then what are you going to do about it? Right.
Yep.
I always talk about that with my school counselors. If you're going to collect data on suicidal ideation, you better be ready. You got to be ready with a team to provide intervention and support. Because once you know, there's no excuse, and it is your ethical responsibility to do something about it. So
Right. That's a big, big question. And not just with those types of things, but you always have to consider, if you want information, then you have to be willing to do something with that information. Not just from an ethical perspective, but also sometimes from a legal and liability perspective as well.
Sure, sure, absolutely. Yeah. And unfortunately, sometimes I think that prevents people from collecting the data, from finding out. It's like, I don't want to know, because then I'd have to do something and I don't have time to do something.
Which, exactly.
Is challenging for sure. Worth conversation, but yeah.
Definitely.
Conversation on this one, Nick. I enjoyed this.
Yeah, very, very good. Which of course, though, brings us to a special part of the episode, which is, I believe, your favorite part always, Rick.
Oh, that's right. It is. Just like every night has its dawn.
Just like every cowboy. Every road has its thorn. And the topic today is near and dear to everyone's heart or their butt. It is items directly related to a toilet in the bathroom. Roses and thorns, items directly related to a toilet in the bathroom. Now, Rick, I know you probably, you know, gave a lot of thought to this one, seeing how very specific it was.
I gave a little bit of thought to it.
Yeah. So I'm curious what you think here. I don't want right. to, I'd hate to start this one and ruin your opinion with my strong feelings on this topic.
All right. I'll go through mine very quickly. Cause again, you're right. You've got strong feelings on this. So, my rose, wet wipes. I'm liking wet wipes.
Yes.
Good stuff. My thorns. I've got three thorns here that I thought of to share. When people put the toilet paper roll on the wrong way, so it should always go over the top, not underneath.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
So, and that bothers me if somebody puts it underneath. Auto flush on toilets, I do not like. You get sprayed. Not a fan of the auto flush. And my least favorite, my biggest thorn, is plunging. I hate plunging. Is just awful. And when you've got a toilet which has like the pipes must be small because it gets clogged all the time. We had, I just shared about kind of our trip to Legoland and Sea World in Orlando. And so we had squeezed six of us, our family of six, into a small hotel room for this. And we were constantly clogging the toilet. And well, we tried to go down and get the plunger just to bring it up and have it. But apparently at that hotel, they had to have their staff come and do it. So it was embarrassing that we had to hide people because we're like, we're not allowed to have six people in this room. So we're like hiding Toby and Holly under the blankets while the plunger guy comes.
Oh, that's fantastic. To the
anyway, those are my roses and thorns. Nick, how about you?
Wow. Well, I'll start with my thorns just because I think the thorns are – there's less thorns than roses for me.
Okay.
I dislike the shape of a toilet and how difficult they are to clean the toilet bowl, meaning I like a fully clean toilet bowl, meaning in order to clean it, you have to actually get on the floor and to get behind the toilet, it's a lot of maneuvering. And sure. I don't particularly like my face being that close, you know, to the toilet area. So I'll have to, I do the spray and the wipe of the underneath as best I can before I get down on the floor. Then when I'm down on the floor, I have to work, you know, like the plastic covers on, you know, on the nuts and bolts there and then work behind. It's just a lot of work to really, you know, get it, really get it clean. So I just feel like I wish there was a better design overall that would make that easier. So that's my biggest thorn.
It's a good point. Do you have a design in mind to make that easier?
I really don't. And it's only because I understand the complexity of pipes and plumbing. So, you know, the toilet has kind of stayed in its, you know, form that it's for hundreds of years at this point. It works. So I'm not smart enough, but I think someone out there is and could invent something that really could probably help this situation and make a lot of people happy. But, you know, that person's not going to be me. I'm just going to complain about, you know, I'm going to complain about it more than anything.
What if Elon Musk designed one of his robots to clean the toilet so people wouldn't have to put their faces close to the bowl?
I mean, I guess that would
cleaning robot.
Yeah, what's that going to cost us? I guess would be the question. Like, is a robot that just cleans toilets like that going to? Is the juice going to be worth the squeeze on the price, or will that robot do other things?
True. I hope they wash their robot hands first.
And you got to disinfect its metal. So
yeah,
maybe we could get Elon on the show to talk about this particular topic.
Probably.
Yeah, he's not doing very much right now.
How about your roses?
two roses. Actually, one of my roses is one of your thorns. So my dad, in the early part of his life, he was a plumber. That's what he did by trade before he left that all behind and went into small business. And he frequently used to say he had a PhD, plumbing, heating, and drainage. That was his big saying there. But for him, and then it passed on to me, there's nothing like when you get the perfect plunge. When you get the plunger into the sweet spot, and you know, as soon as you boom, you know you got it. You know, and then you hear the bubble sound, and then whoosh, yeah, the suction and the it's just an amazing, amazing feeling. And it has to be the right plunger. You know, my dad had a very specific plunger he would use. And, it upsets me when I see people who don't use that exact plunger. It's like you're, of all things, you know, don't cheap out on the plunger. Go for the, get the good plunger.
Is there a particular brand that you go with? Or?
That's not so much a brand as it is, you know, the bell shape, with the suction underneath. And, you know, I can grab a picture or a link to a couple of the good ones for anyone who might question, you know, exactly the type we're talking about. But it's very specific. And my second part is, I'm late to life discovering it. I'm about, since the pandemic is when I, came upon it for the first time for real. And it's changed my life forever. And that's the bidet. The bidet has revolutionized my relationship with pooping and cleaning post-poop. It's just an amazing experience. So clean, so little mess. And just the not having to use toilet paper in the copious amounts that we have in the past. Really has changed the game in a lot of ways. So I can happily use my bidet at home, and I did install one in the office bathroom at school for the men's room, which has changed the game for pooping at work. Rick, I got to tell you, like, I used to hate it. In fact, I'd be like, can I make it till the end of the day and make it home before I even do it? And now, any time of day, if the feeling comes, I will happily, you know, poop in school. Because I'm able to, you know, use the bidet, which is a total game changer. I, you know, for those who have been converted, their testimony should be enough for the people. But believe me when I say, if you take nothing else from any of the episodes where I've imparted wisdom before, this is a game changer. And like $30 or $40, that's all we're talking. It's an easy install. Anyone can do it. All you're doing is attaching, a splitter to the hose on the toilet, literally a 5-second job, and then, you know, unscrewing the toilet seat, putting the bidet on, putting the toilet seat back on. That's it. That's all there is to it.
Yeah, Nick, you've told me about this in the past, and I have put one in our Amazon cart, but I just haven't pulled the trigger on it yet. So, yeah, maybe this conversation will be the little push and nudge I need to go ahead and submit the order.
It's, you know, Rick, it's one of those things where when people stall on it, it's like you totally understand. It just has to, you just have to give it time, because it's only after it happens that the people realize, that it's a life, it's a game changer, total life changer. So, you know, when the time is right, you'll do it. And then your life will never be the same.
All right. All right. Well, on that note, was that the end of your roses, Nick?
Yeah. Plunging and bidets.
Okay. Interesting. you never know what you're going to get, what kind of education you're going to get on the excellent EdVenture, folks. But you've got some control over that because you can send in an email to excellentedventure@gmail.com. And a few folks have done just that, which brings us to our next segment of taking a look at that email bag. And we've got one from Megan from Cape Town, South Africa. Boy, this is a big one too. How do you define success?
That's
heavy.
That's a series of episodes all by itself, right, Rick?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah. And all, well, first and foremost, thank you, Megan. And thank you to all of our listeners in Cape Town. We actually have a few in South Africa, which is great. You know, I'm glad we're on that continent and being able to speak to some listeners there as well. I guess, Rick, I'll just give a very, very short and simple answer to that, because, you know, this is something that I think plagues most of society, wondering, you know, what does success mean? How do I know if I am successful? How do I know if, you know, something is successful? And there's a tons of good answers. You know, we can talk about SMART goals and setting very specific criteria for success and making those criteria as objective as possible. But in some sense, even objective goals are subjective because it's all dependent upon the person who came up with them. And those people are all different. And there's a level of subjectivity to all those things. So there's a quote that I'm a big fan of, and I'll leave it at this by saying the quote says, "Don't strive to be the best in the world at something. Strive to be the best in the world for someone or something." So okay. it's a perspective, right? It's a way to think about things. And it's like, you know, do I want to be the best in the world or do I want to be the best I can be for the world? And for me, success, I think, would be best defined as someone or something that is really doing whatever it is that they're called to do in life to make the world a slightly better place.
Oh, I like idealistic. That. I like that a lot. Yeah, no, but that's good. That's good stuff and certainly relevant to a lot of the folks who are tuning in. So I like that. I'm going to come back to that in just a minute with mine. Anything else you wanted to add before?
No, that's such a big question. I think that's the best I could do on a grand scale.
That's good. Where was that quote from? Was there a person or was that just a saying?
It's a saying that's never really been attributed to one person in particular, but a quick Google search will get you a couple of variations of it.
Yeah, good. I've got three definitions of success. Three. But I'll be quick. One is baking brownies that are chewy in the middle and crispy on the edges. That's success.
Sure is.
I find nothing better than Duncan Hines box brownies. Just follow the recipe. I prefer canola oil for the chewy and crispy, but yeah, that's success. My second one, I think, I don't know if you recall, a few months ago, we did best Christmas movies ever. And my number one was It's a Wonderful Life. And it got me thinking to what's the opposite of success? Success is failure. And Clarence has something to say about failure when he's writing to George at the end, when he kind of leafs through that book and he sees the message from Clarence. And Clarence says to George, "Remember, no man is a failure who has friends." So I think there's something there about success is having friends, people who care about you. And my third one is definition of success is maximizing your potential at whatever you set out to accomplish. Not necessarily achieving it, but it's maximizing your potential. Or I would add this, and I think it's relevant to the quote you shared earlier, Nick, or helping others maximize their potential. I think that's success, is helping somebody maximize their potential. Yeah.
It's a lot. Those are three. There's a lot of ground to cover with those three. Making a great brownie, thinking about friendship, and, you know, figuring out how you maximize success, and whether that's for you directly or for others. You know, it's a lot to think about there. That's a big question, a big, big question. I don't know. It's I guess that's one we should come back to over time, I think.
It's such a big question. Very philosophical.
Well, Greg from Syracuse has a question that might be a little less on the serious side from Megan's question. And he writes, I just listened to you guys talking about the best and worst reboots. What TV show would you like to see get a reboot? I mean, so many of them are getting reboots these days. Anyone in particular, Rick, or a couple in particular that you think?
Oh, one. Nick, I got one that jumps right to the front of my brain on this one. Can I say this? Yeah, I think I can. My favorite sci-fi show of all time, Firefly.
Ooh.
One season, 14 episodes of Firefly. Joss Whedon, I know he's not real popular right now, but man, that show is absolutely fantastic. It got a movie, right? They did a movie, Serenity, afterward. The movie was great too. I loved it as well.
Yeah.
But it is just kind of, there's such a really strong kind of fan base for that show, and for good reason. It's a phenomenal show. So that's the one I'd love to see get a reboot.
Wow, man.
How about for you?
I would take this one kind of as a guilty pleasure, I guess. And in the 80s, some shows hold up, some shows don't hold up quite as well. This might be one that hasn't held up quite as well, but I was a huge Knight Rider fan, a big fan of Knight Rider. And they rebooted it, I think it was around 2010 or so. They rebooted it with a Ford Mustang, and they played through the whole first season. And the reveal at the end of the first season is that the main character was David Hasselhoff's Michael Knight's son. So it was like he was carrying on the legacy. I think it ran two seasons. And then was canceled, ratings, whatever. But I actually enjoyed the new show as well. So I would say it's 15 years after that now. So I think we're due for another Knight Rider reboot. You know, along the same spirit as the show used to be, right? The relationship between a guy and his talking car helping people is kind of what I'd be looking for.
Yeah. We're due for another show like that. I agree.
Yeah, that's kind of where I'd roll.
Nick, something else comes to mind on this topic. We're not talking movies. I think this question was specific for TV shows, right?
It was specific for TV shows.
Well, I had an idea for a movie that I want to see rebooted. Okay?
Nice. Yeah.
Can I add that one in here? Yeah. All right.
Of course you can.
Okay. Jaws. One of the best movies of all time is the original Jaws. I'm a big fan of Jaws 2. But then you know what happened, as well as everybody else, a big nosedive on 3. And number 4, Jaws the Revenge, is one of the worst movies ever made. It gets a 0% critics on Rotten Tomatoes and a 15% from the audience, which I have no idea how it got that. It's really bad. I could not make it through, and I've tried several times. It is that bad.
It's horrible.
We've got this classic movie, right, that is just begging to be rebooted and fix what went wrong. So.
Are you thinking reboot or like a continuation, ignoring the events of Jaws 3 and 4?
Yeah, that'd be all right. I'd be good with that.
Just
something to fix the way it ended, because it's just wrong.
Yeah, here's my problem with Jaws 4. Aside from the fact that it was just a terrible movie, Jaws 1 and 2 were grounded in the real world rules, right? Like there's no sci-fi, there's no supernatural. Right. So sharks don't want revenge. They don't know, you know what I mean? They're just predatory hunters. That's what they do. They hunt. But that shark wanted revenge for his family that had been killed by, and then the way they found them as the most bizarre, like that shark didn't have Google. There was no internet back then. Like how the shark found the if you were going to do that, then you got to go totally into sci-fi, or horror at that point. Yeah. You know what I mean? And, they didn't do that. So you really stretched credibility. And Jaws 3 trying to go 3D and stuff, I mean, maybe we could do a reboot in 3D. I could see that today with like IMAX and, you could make an underwater 3D environment really, really scary, I'm sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And shark movies are still big, right? We got what?
Yeah.
What was the Jason Statham? Down, the Meg.
Yeah.
Is that
The Meg?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. The Shallows. That was a really good shark movie.
Shallows actually was creepy. Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, we're ready. We're primed to have a new Jaws. I don't, it's surprising to me that nobody's done it.
Yeah. I think maybe the Sharknado craze might have put people off on the more serious shark movies for a while, but I've thoroughly enjoyed all the Sharknados.
I have not watched the Sharknados. So,
okay. Yeah. I mean, the first couple, you don't really have to, go too deep into it, but
yeah.
It's an interesting conceit for sure. I wonder if there's actual Sharknados in the future?
But man, that's a good question for somebody who is from the future, right? If we only knew somebody like that, that would be really helpful.
I know. Rufus might have to chime in on what the significance of global natural catastrophes is. Did the Sharknado ever come to pass as a real thing? Well, on that note, Rick, I think we've covered a lot of ground here, a lot of great information to chew up and really work through, covering the full spectrum of the entire world today, from exciting activities that can let you see things from multiple perspectives to two big assets tied to schools and engagement and motivation, all the way to items in the toilet or involving the toilet, to reboots, sharks and Sharknados. We've done it all today.
Yeah, that's covering the gambit right there. That's
yes. Yes, indeed, there is a Sharknado in the future. Did you know that sharks are not only quite funny, but once you learn to communicate with them, they are actually very adept at solving political issues. And so we round them all up, the top of their food chain, so to speak, politically, and put them on a council where we deal with global social political issues. And that council is called Sharknado, much like the NATO you might be familiar with, but with sharks. So there is indeed a Sharknado. If you like the content from Sharknados to things to do with your butt, give us a like or subscribe on your listening podcast service of choice, or go over and interact with us at excellentedventure.com. Until next week, my friends, don't forget to love a lot, laugh a lot, and have a most excellent day.